name is Scott Penner. I'm the lead designer at Flying Helmet Games, working on Eon Altar. I was here yesterday doing some work on a pretty complicated looking puzzle that we're building for our upcoming episode 3. And we are still really hard at work getting this done. So just want to check and make sure my levels are good.
Yeah, sounds like it.
Awesome. Okay, so we're ready to go. Basically yesterday what we did is we brought this into Maya. So it started with a basic design. So let's see if I can give you guys a quick recap here before we get going too quickly. So basically what we had was this guy here. So our designer Wes, who's sitting in the corner over here, did a ton of work to create kind of the mechanical technical part of this puzzle. Basically the idea being that you've got these power supplies. We're calling them power supplies, even though this is kind of like a magic-y, rune-y sort of puzzle. We're kind of treating it like a circuit solver, or like a pipe dream sort of puzzle. So the idea is you've got all these like random shapes, and the power is going to come from basically both of these corners. But as you start to flip these switches, the power is going to connect up. And if you manage to connect it to any of the other edges, then it will power that edge. And what we do is in our map, we'll just load up Unity while we're waiting here. In our level, what we have is you walk down this pathway towards a pretty big platform that contains this puzzle. And depending on how you manage to power the puzzle, different bridges are going to show up that connect you to different parts of the level. So this is kind of like the central hub for the second session and episode. Second chapter, I suppose we're using chapters. Second chapter in episode 3. What I did then is yesterday I took this this puzzle design, and I knew because of the architecture of the ancient creatures that built it, we didn't want to use kind of like square grid patterns because it doesn't really fit into the like sleek, curvy, streamlined architecture that we're using elsewhere for them. So once Unity opens, I'll just quickly show you what I mean by that architecture. Big white screen, awesome. So what we did is we actually went into Photoshop yesterday, and we, let's see if I can find the design here. Oh, can't find it. Circle puzzle. Not there. But what we did is we basically took that puzzle and I brought it into Photoshop, where I started to do some playing around with the shape. I'm just going to open that up here so you can see what we're talking about. So basically drawing rings out of shapes in Photoshop to try and figure out what a grid pattern would translate to if we turned it into a ring. So what you can see here is like a much nicer kind of like curvy, sleek, streamlined sort of flow that still has the same functionality as a grid puzzle, but now it'll work much better in a ring, which I think the level should be open now. So if I just kind of go over here in the corner, you can see I've been working with this kind of ancient people called the Draymore. They're the ones who constructed most of this stuff eons ago. And what I've kind of done already is I've already built some just kind of random architecture bits that we're going to be tossing into our levels. These kind of like what you can see basically sandstone sort of looking things with kind of like, you know, eroded and weathered over time to give this kind of sleek, smooth appearance. We've also kind of suggested that maybe these guys are using, you know, a bit of magic to craft their stuff. So, you know, definitely kind of in the alien fantastical sort of realm here. Also, what we're using is this kind of energy line pattern that's kind of become part of what you see when you encounter destiny markers. So there's this godstone kind of inlay that goes into these things, and what we wanted to do is use that inlay as a as a way to remind players that this is like it's powered by some sort of magical energy, and from there, what I was talking about is this pathway that leads down to what is now. And from those of you who were watching the stream yesterday, know that I kind of got stuck trying to get it into the level. But what you see here is I've got my three rings, and they've been set up properly. The geometry is still kind of yucky. If I had the time and the need to go back and clean it up, I probably would. But in general, I think it's low poly enough. The tries are clean enough, and the only thing that going back and cleaning this up would get me is really wanting to just kind of clean up the corners, because you can see how on any of these things, close up, anyways, there aren't really any hard edges. They're all kind of very smooth and soft, and this puzzle here kind of has a bit more of an angular, hard-edged sort of look, but I think that's fine for today. With a bit of time, I might go back and clean this up later, but basically, that's kind of where we're at now. So what I've done is I'm going back into Maya here because we've got a little bit more work to do on the art before we can actually get going. So the first thing that I've done is I can just hide this guy. We're not using him right now, but
apparently you are a tad quiet.
Oh, just a tad quiet. Okay, well,
that's what Talarian's telling us.
Let's
right
see
now.
If I can just crank up the audio volume here a little bit.
Is there a well, that's the headset volume. Can I crank it up further? Is that better?
Who knows? Just speak straight into the mic clearly and concisely. Tip of the tongue and the teeth and the lips. Okay. So what I have over here, I was just playing around with the idea of using these kind of little side pillars as like a connector. So it'll look have the appearance of energy going up and over and down and into the water underneath. So we get the this kind of cheater way of connecting the power. But the other thing that I've done is I've gone ahead and I've grabbed all of these elements in the middle, and I've duplicated them, and I've just grabbed only the faces that correspond to the energy lens. And what that leaves me with is a whole bunch of these kind of terribly, I'm not even going to bother renaming them, terribly named pieces that are going to be, they've been separated, and they represent the connector bits, the energy connector bits that I'm going to inlay into the designs in Unity. So what I can do here is I can actually just grab all of this. I'm going to go file. Actually, what I might want to do is just export these separately. File. Actually, if I bring them in together, then it'll actually keep their structure and their shape, which is kind of handy. So I'm going to go file, export selection. Just going to call this one Hobby Design. I'm just going to call this one Energy Lines. Oh, Hob Energy Lines is probably better. Just wait for that to finish. Lines of the puzzle insets too. Yes, I am bringing those in. That's as designed. Because they're all separated mesh pieces, I can actually bring them in. When I get them into Unity, they will actually be separated. Like they're separate objects. They'll just come in as one big prefab, which is really handy. Okay, so I've got Hob Energy Lines, and I can just drag and drop that file into my scene. So I do have three monitors here, so you're not seeing everything on screen. But here's my Energy Lines prefab. So I've just brought this in. You'll also notice I don't have a prefabs built yet for the centerpiece. So I might actually just grab this hub puzzle and just quickly make a prefab for it as well. And remember, I always save the project when I create prefabs because Unity has a terrible tendency to not remember that these things have changed, and then you just end up with these weird, blank, gross things. Actually, the other thing that I've done here that's terrible, 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 is I've put them in the wrong spot. So let's move them to the right location. Energy lines go into the hub puzzle folder. There we go. So these are all the hub actual mesh objects. So when you bring in mesh, you've got to make sure that it's using the right scale factor. We use 0.01, which is generally on point. We don't need blend shapes. I'm not going to make it do that. It's not animated, so we're not going to add a rig.
Now, can you bring in the entire mesh line or the energy lines all as one, or is that going to cause problems for me when I try to turn them on and off?
Well, one of the fun things, so Wes has just asked if we can bring them in all together, if we have to bring them in one by one. And one of the fun things, and it looks like Unity might have crashed, which is what it's wanted to do when you do import things like this. I'll give it a minute. When you bring in an OBJ that has separated objects, like you can have like a hierarchy of stuff. So like,
Okay. Like
you can have like, you know, cube, sphere, and triangle, or a pyramid, prism, but if they're all separate objects, then what it'll do is it'll bring in the object as like a prefab that contains three separate objects underneath it. And
oh,
you can
so
actually grab the mesh.
It will actually respect the way that you delineated it in Maya.
It'll respect how you've separated them in Maya.
Yeah.
So the cool thing there is now basically I've got a prefab that is zeroed, like the pivot of it is actually at the zero of the circle, and I can drag and drop that straight onto the hub that I've built already. And yeah, it looks like Unity has crashed because it hates importing things, and nothing is easy. Everything is broken. Unity editor, I'll just restart that.
Happy Friday, everybody.
Happy Friday. Well, actually, interestingly enough, Tilarian, we can't actually mesh combine those objects because they are not going to be static. All of those individual pieces are, well, we'll see. Basically, what we're doing is we're bringing them in as they're like kind of like train tracks, if you consider it that way. They have to be separated because we're going to be turning them on and off individually. That's the important bit. So let's see if it's respected any of the changes that I've made here. Honestly, the poly count for this section, yeah, it's totally borked. Okay, so no rig. I'm just going to turn the blend shapes back on and apply the change and see if that takes. Yeah, it looks like it has. Still no rig. The model is brought in. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag and drop this into my hub bridge. Sorry, my hub. Oh, the scene didn't save, that's why. So where's my prefabs folder? Unity, why you gotta do me like this? Mines, new Dreamware, hub puzzle, and I'm gonna make sure that we're using a prefab instead of the original. Hub puzzle, paste component values. I'm gonna delete the old puzzle. Cool, so now I've got my prefab here and I've got my energy lines. I'm just gonna drag and drop them in and I'm gonna zero out the transforms. Intriguingly enough, not showing up quite the way that I'd hoped, so let's take a look. First of all, the objects that I'm using here, when I was building them in Maya, I wasn't really paying attention to scale. I was more concerned with just keeping the general shape of the puzzle, so I wasn't really considering like how big a character would be or anything. So when I brought it back into the scene, I kind of resized it using the scale to try and make it match what Wes had set up in the level. So you can see that my scale here for these objects is set to 20, which means that it's like 20 times bigger than I thought it would be. So my energy lines need to also be equivalently large. I'm also going to use the pivot here. So it looks like it actually didn't set it to zero, which is kind of mean. Kind of mean. Which means now I kind of have to eyeball them back into position. That's okay. I have good eyeballs. So just drag this down a little bit so they sit nicely in their grooves. And because the mesh is like, it's pixel perfect, it's gonna just neatly slot right in there. And that is good. So now I have the energy inlay. You can see that I still have like the curve and the straight piece. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab straight and curved, and I'm actually going to drag them out of that chain, and I'm going to break this prefab connection. Oh, it's already broken. It's fine. And then I'm going to apply those changes to my puzzle, and now all of those pieces are now neatly, awesomely kind of attached to that prefab. So again, what I can do is, like, now if I wanted to grab that chunk, I can actually grab it separately. Super handy. The next thing that's probably worth doing is grabbing these energy lines and actually attaching them as children of the hub part that they're supposed to be connected to. So this is the middle. Lots of objects in the middle here. And this is going to be a time-consuming process. I'm not looking forward to. Hub inner. Then, okay, what are we looking at here? This is middle. Inner. Outer. Straight and curved. So then the, where are my puzzle pieces here? Don't think I have them right now. Go back to our art folder. Hub puzzle. Here we go. Curved.
Oh, which pieces are you looking, for the piece prefabs that I made or?
Nope.
Oh, okay.
Nope, we're good. I don't think I've set these ones up yet. Yeah, okay, so scale factors. Go to set the scale factor here. Blend shapes, apply. No rig. Remember to save my project. And there we go. So, infuriatingly, I may have to make a fix here. Something that I've done here is I've actually set the pivot of this circle to the wrong spot. So I might have to take this back into Maya briefly to fix it, because it's gonna make going to make animating it a real chore. As Wes will tell me, having pivots in the wrong spot is an enormous pain. Okay, so let's worry about the puzzle pieces here in a minute. What I still have to do is set up the materials for these guys. So they're all separate objects. They'll all kind of animate and turn on and off. In their own way, but what I need to do now is create a material for them that allows them to turn on and off. I have a materials folder with a new Draymar section, and what I need to do, I'm actually just going to open this up quickly. This is an emissive map for one of the other objects that I was using. The emissive maps we're using as like the glow effect that shows up on other objects. And what I need to do here, because I'm basically just applying a really simple, like, small texture. I can even make this like a 64 by 64 bit texture, because I'm only going to use it once. And I'm just going to paste in the color of the emissive channel. And I'm just going to create an alpha channel that is totally white. And I'm going to save this as, doing more tests. I'm just going to save this one as emissive godstone. And it's going to be a targa. And so the reason for this is, like, basically when I make the other objects, I kind of assume that all of the inlaid like energy lines are either going to be on or off. Like, I don't have any, like, if I create like a pillar with a line of energy running through it, we get to turn either the whole thing on or off. So I actually bake the emissive part of that map into the texture for that object. But for these energy lines, the interesting thing is, like, they are just the godstone inlay. So I don't even need any special fancy textures or anything to make that work. But what I do need is just another little custom special map that I can use to kind of toss onto them. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to go create material, and I'm just going to call this one Godstone Inlay. And I'm going to find the emissive Godstone texture. And that's good. I can actually set the maximum size to 64 because it is tiny. And with my Godstone inlay, we're going to set this to use. We've been using a special shader for diffuse, specular, emissive, and normal. It's a little bit overkill for this one, but I think it's it'll make sure that it has the same general look as the rest of as the rest of all of our objects. And then finally, I actually do have a special texture that I've started using for our Godstone that I can dump into the diffuse channel. I don't believe I have a specular. I do have a specular map for that right now. No normal maps. These are just flat objects. They don't need a normal map. So all I have to do now is just grab the energy lines. Yep.
Apparently, the mic sensitivity is fairly high, that it's detecting of like sounds near, like whenever you move your hands or something.
Oh.
So there's a bit of a boom.
Okay.
It's
boom.
Coming in whenever you sort of like move your hands from one spot to the next.
I'll be careful. I'll try not to boom you.
Design like a safe cracker.
I will. Handsy. Okay,
but yeah,
so.
No, apparently it is just, it's just, to Larry's hand, it's just too close to your hands.
I do have a.
I don't know what the knob does.
I don't, there's like weird fiddly
there's,
bits.
There's cryptic symbols on the knob,
there's a,
and I don't trust them.
Yeah, there's a gain and a pattern. I don't know what the pattern does. I figure if I like click it, it'll probably just like screech loudly into people's ears.
I don't think it'll screech, but it might affect it. I had selected that one only because previous to that, it sounded like I was in a like laundromat. It just sort of had a general buzzing feedback that has been on our previous streams.
All right. Yeah, I'll be careful with my. Too close to my hands. Well, maybe I can just move this off to the side a little bit more then. There. Maybe that's a bit better. I think it'll be like either too loud or too quiet or too boomy. I don't know if I've got an option. It is a good mic though. Okay.
It is a good mic.
So, what I was just doing here is I was just grabbing the street and the curved objects, and we're just adding the Godstone inlay material to these objects. For some reason, this one didn't pick up. Oh, I didn't name it right. There's probably one missing here, this guy here. So, with that done, all of the inlay for this puzzle has now been placed. And the cool thing here is I can actually grab that hub and I can move it independently. You can even put it underwater, which looks pretty killer. And so now, basically, that's set up to go. So again, if I grab the material, and when Unity runs, the cool thing it does is it actually instantiates the material for like every object. So even though I have this material with its own luminance, I can turn it on and off at will. The cool thing about the way that Unity handles materials is that I can actually independently animate all of these materials at runtime. So you know, if this particular bracket section is supposed to be lined up lit, but then the sections beside it are not, then I can totally do that. That's easy. Okay, so let's take a second, take a deep breath, and what I need to do now before I do anything else is I need to go back into Maya and I need to just briefly fix the pivots for these objects because they are terrible. So we're going to go into our art folder, hub puzzle, and I have straight and curved objects that are broken. So I'm just going to show that in Explorer. And I'm going to go back into Maya. I'm going to save this because I'm done with it. This is the straight object. And you can see that it's like it's offset from the center. And that's because when I was building them, I think if for people who were watching yesterday, you saw like I, you know, minus 20. Moved it away from center, you know, plus 20 moved it away from center, and it was like neat. And I was like, hooray, symmetry is like exactly where it should be. But the unfortunate thing there is that, I forgot that if I export it, it keeps those pivots. And so even though it's where it's supposed to be, it doesn't actually rotate properly. And if I'm gonna treat these as separate objects, separate prefabs, then I just have to reset their position. So just move the translate back to -20, back to where it's supposed to be in center,
I remember the numbers, and then I just go freeze transformations, and it assumes that's where its home is now. And now I can just go file export selection, and this is the folder that it was in, so I can just re-export that as straight. Yep. And then I'm gonna do the same thing for the curved object. And file freeze transformations, file export selection. I'm not changing anything other than just its pivot points. Curved, yep. File. Okay, we're done in Maya. We go back into Unity, and you'll notice it took a second to re-import these objects. I still haven't set them up in terms of their, 1 second, import mesh. Import materials should be off, so I'm not sure why that brought that in. So this one is set up now. The straight object still needs to be 0, 1, no bone shapes, and no rig. We're not animating this object, at least not using a bone rig. Okay, and finally, what we can do is we can drop one of these guys into our scene. You can see that it's way too tiny because it needs to be 20 times larger. And the sad part here is that I won't be able to snap any of these things. It's not like there's a snap point that I can find. So I do kind of have to eyeball this one at least into position before I can deal with this later. So this is a curved section. I'm going to drag this one out to lose that prefab because I want to build a new prefab after it. Actually, I don't need to do that. Never mind. I can keep this. No, I can't. 1, 1, 1. You never want to change the scale of your parent. You always want to change the scale of the object itself. That's a bit better. So now you can see that like the pivot point is in the middle. If I rotate it, it spins properly. Not exactly lined up, and I think that's because we decided yesterday that this needs to be a little bit smaller. I'm going to drag this into my puzzle section, curved, and I'm going to find the... Where's my curved? Oh, it's over there. Okay, never mind. Curved. Move this over here, where it belongs. How are we doing? Good, good, good. For those of you who are following along on the Twitch channel, or for those of you who are following along and have no idea what I'm doing, again, we're just setting up a puzzle for the impending, but yet unannounced, release of our third episode. This puzzle is in the second chapter of this. I need more coffee. Done. We're working on a game called Eon Altar. For those of you who haven't played Eon Altar, it's a fantasy role-playing game that you play with your own mobile device. It's a couch co-op game, and it's available on Steam right now, and we just launched our demo. So for those of you who haven't tried it, just go onto Steam and you can get our demo for free. We do our first chapter, which we're calling the Prelude, is available there. Okay, so finally, last thing I have to do is just find my material for this object, and I think I called it generic godstone. Yeah. And it's in the right spot now, but what I want to do is I want to separate it, and I'm gonna call this hub curved. Maybe I'll even give it a better name, like hub cookie, because we talked about cookies yesterday. Everybody loves cookies. Go back into my prefabs. I'm getting audio static. Microsophone. Okay, cookie curved. I'm gonna go back here. Yeah, I've moved my phone, so hopefully that fixes that issue. It's good to have tech support in your Twitch channel. Okay, cookie curved. I'm gonna make a prefab of that. It's done. So now I can use this kind of over and over and over again. I'm gonna apply the changes to my hub puzzle. I have one more thing to do, and that is I need to build the straight section. So we're gonna bring in the straight prefab.
I'm still enjoying. Need more coffee. Done.
Ah, thanks.
Just really, really quickly, quest unlocked. Drink more coffee.
Yeah.
Complete.
Nailed it. Alrighty. Okay. So we've got our bridge, our straight section. I need to, zeroed. Move the parent. Bring this guy up into position. Generally trying to eyeball it along the lines of this guy here. So that it kind of lines up. And ultimately, one of the things I'm going to have to do with this prefab is set the scale. So that looks like perfectly flush, which actually I don't want. We want the players to know that it can be moved if it needs to be. So having a little bit of a gap in between the puzzle piece and the puzzle that it slots into is generally a good idea. So I'm going to grab the inlay piece and slide it up here. And I'm just going to make this a prefab now. Prefabs. We're going to call this one hub cookie straight. Good news, everybody. Our puzzle pieces are now built. And I'm just going to grab, so the mesh objects, wait a second, hub cookie curved. Where's my inlay piece? Did I not move it? Curved group one. There we go. Apply. Is there more coffee made, Wes? Is that a thing? Or did you drink the last of it? It's the most important question in any office, really.
Truly it is. I will investigate the coffee situation.
Okay, so... So interestingly enough, this one came in slightly smaller than it was supposed to be, but this one came in a tiny bit too big. So I'm gonna like manually make that one a bit smaller. And that should be good.
Still a cup worth of yesterday reheated coffee.
That's good enough. Let me grab some in a minute. Okay, so what you can see now is, I can do a quick recap. We have our entryway leads to this bridge. I think about 15,000 people consuming it for 15 minutes apiece. That's 3750. Trying to do some math to justify the amount of work I'm doing on this. I think you also have to, like, I think... Like, we're designers, and, like, so, okay, you have to do the math, and you think, okay, if I'm making a game, I think, like, the really depressing stat is that, like, what is it, like, 90% of people will only play 10% of your game, so it's, like, if that were the case, we should only make 10% of our game, because then we're gonna get, like, a 90% review rating. That's pretty awesome. Just make 10% of a video game and you're good to go. But it doesn't work that way, because the 10% of the people are going to say, hey, wait, I just got to level one of, like, level 2 out of 10, and there's no content here. Everything looks like a gray box. Joke's on you. So you have to finish it.
Yeah.
For, like, the sake of the like, 10% of the people who will actually play and enjoy it. And it is actually a really depressing stat, knowing that, like for example, we spent 2 months making the Combat Arena 2 for episode 2.
Yep.
And I think we have some, like, it's a very small percent of the people who have played episode 2, which in of itself is a very small percentage of the total people who have bought our game.
Yes.
It's like, kind of enough to make you want to, like, sit back and take a deep breath, but at the end of the day, you know, we made something that we're proud of. We have fun playing it, and if for no other reason, we enjoy making it. So, you know, I'm here making this puzzle, and, like, one of the things that I find really rewarding about my job is that, just make chapter 1 super long. One of the things that I find rewarding about my job is that I get to do stuff like this every day, and I get to look at problems that I've never faced before, and try and solve them. And when you get to solve new challenges at work on a daily basis, it's really, really rewarding. I just don't know if I could do the kind of job where I have to sit and do the same task over and over and over again. I would just go so bored. I would get so bored.
I think we both have had those jobs in the past.
I have. Yeah, it's the worst.
I think we both know. Not again.
it's pretty much the worst. Okay, so before anything else, I'm going to save the project and save my scene. I was paranoid that Unity's going to crash and I'm going to lose all my work. So I'm going to give it a minute. Now, where are we at? Okay, so we've got our puzzle laid out. We've got our interactable cookies. Well, they're not interactable yet. All of our meshing is done. The puzzle is placed. Really, I think where we're at now, Wes, is we have a lot of work to do to now make it interactive.
To make it interactive?
Yeah.
There's not... I wouldn't even know that... I wouldn't say there's too much work, actually. I'm hoping.
He says, with his fingers crossed.
For the most part, you should be able to take the existing Switch prefabs that I made and give them fresh art, and they should be usable right away.
Fresh art. Well, there are a couple of things that are going to have to happen here. The first thing that's going to have to happen is, well, I'm going to move this up and I'm going to turn it on so you can see the old puzzle as it existed previously.
Yeah.
So this is pretty interesting. So you have a series of straight and curved angles. So I guess one of the first things that I should do is probably set out my cookie piece prefabs in the right orientation, I guess, is probably where I'm going to start. So once again, I'm going to go to the desktop. I'm going to load up my puzzle layout. Actually, what I can do is I can go into Photoshop and I can look at this puzzle, because this actually has the correct layout on it. And for the benefit of, it's not for the benefit of you guys, but more for me, I'm just going to drag this off my screen so I can see it on my second monitor. And I'm just going to be using that as a reference as I place. So now back in Unity, I'm going to make sure that I'm aligned to the bottom here, so that the place where the players walk in and see this puzzle. I guess the one last note about this puzzle for Paulson, G. Paulson, is Gary Paulson? Was that the guy's name from Fight Club?
No, it's Robert.
Oh, Robert Paulson.
Yeah.
Maybe G. Paulson's his brother. That was one of the solutions. Yeah, I know there are some solutions. You guys are getting tons of spoilers here. For those of you who are watching, try not to spoil too much. Great. Okay, so I have my solution open on the side, and I'm just going to start placing these objects where they ought to be. Now... this curved section is in the wrong place. That actually needs to go over here. And we need another one over here. One more thing that might actually be really useful for me is if I place these underneath the hub puzzle, then one of the things that's going to be useful here is, because the zero position of this locally is placed exactly where it's supposed to be, when I go to place these guys, hypothetically, now that's strange, pivot. Weird. Supposed to be in the right spot, but it's not. Oh well, I can eyeball it. So using a world position, I wanted it to have a local position. Yeah, sorry, I got distracted. This is not only is this just a puzzle that you're gonna see in the second chapter of session two, but it's also kind of the main puzzle that's going to branch you out to the other areas of the level. So you will see it more often than not. It's really important for us to make sure that it has, you know, strong visual impact, makes you feel like you've gotten somewhere special, and it's kind of like a reward when you manage to light up new areas. Playily entertaining. It's a word if we want it to be a word. Okay, inside is done. Let's move on to the outside. That one is going to be a straight section. Now, the interesting part here is I'm going to have to start doing a bit of math. Which isn't... I guess it's good if you like math. Nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with liking math.
Isn't there? Like a little?
I guess there's a little bit wrong
with
liking
math. There's a
little
bit wrong with liking math.
To make me happy, I'm going to go to a top-down view, make an orthographic view, so I can see it kind of more pixel-perfect and make sure that I'm lining these up kind of where they're supposed to be. I don't think anybody's going to notice if they're not in exactly the right spot, but somebody will. Somebody's going to notice. Minus 30. Two in a row here, that's interesting. Damn right. Okay. This one is minus 30. Or not. What's the rotation here? 90 degrees. So the way that we've built this, I'm going to give you a little bit of a preface because the next section is going to get interesting. For those of you who are a little bit more programmatically or game design inclined, what I've done as I'm doing this kind of tedious work, I'll talk through it, is I've developed a script that basically takes a series of input and output nodes, and it determines if they're next to or near to other input and output nodes, and decides based on the charged state of those other nodes whether or not this new link should be also activated. And in layman terms, that means that I can actually set up individual chains, individual links on the chain of an electricity grid. So we have this thing called the circuit manager that I'm hoping, well, I'm not hoping, Wes has already tested it and it works perfectly, but I'm hoping that what I can do is just slot this in and everything will work more or less as expected. Fingers crossed. The other thing that I've done is I've added a bit of tolerance. So you'll notice that there are gaps between these pieces. And that's more just to make sure that, you know, we don't have to give a suggestion that they're exactly correctly aligned. They don't need to be. They can be offset slightly. The system that I've built will account for that. It will, that they don't have to be exactly on top of each other. 16, there we go. And finally, 60. The other thing is that because we've already kind of done the legwork to make sure that all of these pieces are in the right configuration, I've already drawn up all of the solutions for the puzzle, so we know that they are reliably solvable. Hopefully, once we just hook up the existing design that Wes had created for us, this will all just be functional. And one last piece, which is going to be a curved section here. That one's fiddly, I don't know why. It's this way. And that's all of them. So for, it's just the light source is in the right spot there. Let me just move this point light a little bit so that it's right on top. Right in the middle. Cool. Perspective view. So all of our pieces are connected and lined up. That's pretty awesome. What we're gonna do is we're gonna try and create the suggestion that this particular area is where the power is coming from. And these individual cookies are going to become interactable objects. So as the players walk down the ramp, they can target them individually and use them individually. Not only that, but they can also be used by players in tandem. So like one player can be turning one while another player turns the other. So quite possibly you will end up with a scenario where players can screw with each other as well as help each other. Awesome. Okay, so that's the hub puzzle set up. I'm going to save the project. I'm going to save the scene again. All the pieces are in place. It's taken us, you know, the equivalent of probably about a day of work to do all of this so far, just to get the mesh in place and the amount of time. Well, it's taken days for Wes to get the puzzle set up properly. And once we're ready, I'm going to turn the circuit manager back on and we're going to see how we can start pulling from it. I'm going to drag it off to the side. And let's just turn the lights off here. Okay, so power node one. Power node 2. I don't even know what those are. Those are just game objects. Aha, power node 1, power node 2. We're going to have to start placing some of these where they need to go. Brings up the whole 15 minutes of content thing. It's why MMOs struggle with content creation versus player consumption. Even simple quests have a lot of man hours behind them setting them up. Yeah, procedural generation is really good. The problem with procedural generation is that it's actually quite difficult to make procedural content that feels like the developers or the designers cared enough about the work that they were doing. It kind of ends up feeling mechanical. So it actually takes a lot of work to take procedural content and make it feel like it was designed. Yeah, soulless. I'm gonna turn off my Draymar arches just so I can see what's happening here. I think there's a happy medium between procedurally generated content and design placed content. I feel like it's, you know, if you have like a really specific story to tell, procedural is terrible. Because you can't really use procedural content to like craft the world and the story and the characters in a really interesting way.
Yeah.
Especially if the story is extremely explicit, like for an adventure game, for example, procedural just wouldn't work at all. But
in certain situations, I will say, like there's unfortunately, at least one example, which is Dwarf Fortress.
Dwarf Fortress.
Which is a game that is procedurally generated that does deliver incredible storylines. It's just incredibly complicated to play, and it has to really pull back on the graphics. It is 100% ASCII art.
Yeah.
And it's generated entirely through that. But, yeah, it doesn't actually let you tell your story. It just tells a generated story.
Yeah.
And in that particular case, generated stories sometimes end up amazing. Like, I've heard some fantastic stories come out of it, but it's not reliable. It could be bad.
Yeah, that's true. Wes, what are you up to now? I might actually borrow you for a minute.
I think because you
actually built this original system, and if you wanted to wheel your chair over, maybe you can help talk me through what you've done here. So what you can see, before I move it, I've moved these in a weird way. This is Wes again, he's our designer. I think these were over here initially.
Yes, they were.
And I moved them in a weird way. Oh, that's why. Ah! Ack! Unity freezing up on me. Let's just move them back where they were supposed to be. So those were the power nodes.
Yes. So right now that piece in the bottom right corner controls which set of those are on, basically, or which power manager is being run.
Right. So I know that that piece corresponds to this piece here.
Yes.
So what I want to do is that true? It should have been true.
These
two connectors, I think,
yes,
here are the ones that I want to be powering.
Yep.
So if I, in fact, drag these over here, what I'm trying to do is place all of these nodes again.
Oh.
So that they're in the right spot. And then we'll turn off the spheres. Because I will be happy if they were all in the right positions. So this one actually does correspond to the bottom node. This one corresponds to the side node. So if I grab power node 2, and I rotate it kind of like that, I'm assuming
the only one that matters is the front ball there.
This ball is what's connecting to the cookie, right?
Yes.
It doesn't matter how it's rotated.
Yeah, the other one is there just for the purposes of it existing. It just needs to for the code to play nice.
Right. But wherever possible, we're going to make sure that these other spheres kind of connect to the outside ridge, because eventually I think what we'll do is hook up the outside as well so it can be powered. So that's the first set of power nodes connected. And then
the rest of them, you might actually have an easier time if you actually just built a corner piece and a straight piece and then just redropped your cookies in.
Right. Well, what I was thinking of doing is just copying the data into like two of these guys.
Oh, okay.
And then just
and
updating
then just
the prefab.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So this is a straight section here, a routing switch. That's our first switch. Is there anything special about this one?
Yes.
Okay.
So that one is your essentially third switch. It's FSM controls which of these circuit managers is active right now.
Gotcha. So if I maybe just place that where it's supposed to be. I'm breaking everything, Wes.
That's a good start.
You gotta
make a mess to clean it up, I guess.
You gotta. Okay. I'm gonna delete the visuals.
So anything inside of the FSM basically rotates the rotating folder.
Gotcha.
So anything you put inside of that will spin, in this particular case, a quarter turn.
Gotcha. So that's handy. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to grab that guy, move it up there. And I'm going to move this one. Oh, the cube can go too. And grab this one and move it down there. And that should... Oh, but then this one has to be rotated back into this position.
Yep.
That should be it, right?
That should be it.
So that's your routing switch.
Yeah.
Got my power nodes, a routing switch. And as I go, I'm just going to actually wondering. It's going to get noisy really quickly here, but I'm actually going to start dragging these out into the puzzle.
You might want to move the circuit managers down. Well,
do they need to go in a specific place or position?
The circuit managers? No. They just exist.
So,
though, I think if you go the route of updating it... Well, actually, it won't matter either way. Once you actually finish updating all of these things, you're going to have to go through the circuit managers again and hook up all the nodes.
Yes, power node.
Because it's gonna forget them by the end of this.
By the time I'm done.
By the time you're done.
Okay, so I'm going to take 10 seconds and just really quickly talk with Wes about what's happening here. So I have this script called Circuit Manager. What this does is... I'm not going to open my ball up and up. I'll show you the script. And then our senior programmer can look at it and be like, what the hell are you doing? This is terrible. Really what it's doing is it has a list of nodes. I'm calling them nodes. These are like, imagine like on a electrical circuit, these are like the outlets, basically. And what it's going to do is I have a function here that allows me to check for the closest nodes or traverse connected paths. So what it's going to do is it's going to start with the power source node, which is like the wall, basically. It's like your outlet. And it's going to go through all of the nodes that we assign to it in the chain. And it's going to say, hey, are any of these nodes actually connected to the outlet? Like, are any of them within like a tiny tolerance of distance from the outlet? And if that's true, then obviously that node should be powered. So it goes,
we're
hey.
We're working in the context of the metaphor, we're suggesting the wire, I think.
The wire, it's the wire. So, hey, this wire needs to be turned on. So imagine like our first node is like the extension cord.
Yeah.
So, okay, extension cord now has power. And when it gets kicked on, it also is going to call is it still here? There's another object, which is the node, and it has a Playmaker FSM. So it calls an event to say, hey, we've been charged. And we can now do events like turn on, like we can make the emissive channel light up.
Yes.
We can make the thing spin. We can play a sound effect. We can do whatever we need to.
Technically anything.
And it that's all kind of connected to the object's prefab itself. So
it's
really easy for us to do that at that point. The other thing that it's going to do is it's going to then check to see if any of the nodes that are attached to this circuit are not connected. And if any of them are not connected, it will also kind of quietly make sure that they're discharged, they're turned off.
Yep.
So is it unplugged, basically? And the downside of this method is that it kind of requires us to have one path. There can only be like basically one power source. There can only be one. So it kind of follows a one continuous chain from beginning to end. And as soon as it hits the, you know, a natural endpoint where it can't find any more connections, that's it. It's done. It stops searching.
Yep.
So it's really useful for us if you only have one outlet and you don't want it to be able to split. So in order for us to do splits, basically what we have to do is we have to take this circuit manager, and then when we want to do the split, we actually have to have it turn on three new circuit managers or two new circuit managers to do that split. And then those circuit managers have to, you know, figure out what they're doing.
Yeah.
So it does get pretty complicated. Luckily, this puzzle is actually pretty simple.
It is. We only actually need two, and that's only because of a little bit of complexity that I wanted to keep in.
Yes. We've got our circuit managers and our first two actual like outlet nodes set up. We also have our routing switch set up right here. And now we want to go through the process of setting up our straight and curved cookies as well. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to find a corner piece. And where is this one located? Curved. That's this one here. So if I grab this corner piece and I hold down the V key, I can actually snap it straight to the center of that piece. And just move it down a little bit more into position until it's just floating above. It's already pretty close, and I'm going to turn off the cube. I'm going to turn off this cube, and this circle. I'm going to grab this object. I'm going to drag it over, line it up to the edge. Again, I have a little tolerance set up. So that if there is a little gap between here, it's got like a
half a unit.
of tolerance. So if they're relatively close together, like within this sort of area, it should be fine. So that should actually be fine. So then puzzle piece corner, I'm going to grab all of this and I'm just going to drag that straight into my curved object like that. And now it's all connected here. Oops. So now if I rotate the puzzle piece, it should all kind of line up properly. Theoretically, let's make sure.
Theoretically.
Eh, close enough. Well, that's 90. I think it'll be close enough in tolerance that it'll kind of make sense. And we can fix the prefabs later. so that they actually line up properly. This outside ring is like mathematically precise. So.
But you will have to for the curve piece, like you have to drop the art assets of the existing curve piece into the rotating game object.
How do you mean?
In there, so like the game objects that are currently what it looks like.
Yeah.
If you put those inside of the rotating folder, it'll actually give it the appearance of turning when you activate it.
Gotcha. Done. So that's our puzzle piece corner.
Yep.
And actually, remarkably, bug. So Unity is actually the worst. It is literally the worst because
just gonna denounce it outright today.
And they still haven't fixed this problem. If you put a prefab into another bunch of prefabs and you apply the change to the top level prefab, you will lose all of your prefabs. So hub cookie curved needs to be fixed. That's just a thing. You gotta, if you're gonna use prefabs, you absolutely positively can't nest them, which is lame. I was looking there, I'm like, I'm gonna break something here. I'm pretty certain this is gonna break. So then I'm gonna grab this street section. Where is that one located? Oh, that's mine. Where's yours? Street puzzle piece street. Again, I'm gonna grab that, snap it over here. And then I'm going to kind of do the same thing. I'm gonna delete the cube. I'm gonna delete the other cube.
And the circle.
And
yeah.
The circle. I'm gonna grab puzzle piece straight. I'm gonna drag it straight into there. I'm gonna grab these guys, move them into the rotating. And make sure that the spheres are properly aligned. So what I'm hoping here is that because of the, and then I have to reassign this to the straight section. Place anyway. Let's just double check. Oh, what happened here? I put it in the wrong spot. I think I made a boo-boo. It's in the wrong straight section. Let's try that now. That's better.
I agree with Talarian in chat.
What's he saying?
Oh, that sphere is, it's a weird word if you keep saying it.
Sphere. Moist.
It's one of those words that after writing it down enough times, you're like, SP here. And the word just sort of breaks down into other sorts of words and letters.
It really does.
It blows my mind.
Ugh. Okay. I'm going to have to take a second here and fix this because it's going to get bad ugly. It's going to get ugly quickly. What is happening? What have I done? Those are all in the right spots. Why?
Did you somehow create another, like an additional prefab on top of that one?
I must have. Hub cookie straight, gone. Hub cookie straight, on. You're the one that I want. But then this one is in a weird spot. So now all of these pieces have to come out. Continue. Puzzle piece straight needs to go in the middle.
Well, technically you could get rid of puzzle piece straight.
I could just get rid of it. And now this one rotates properly.
Cool.
So hub cookie straight is done. So those are our prefabs. Those are our interactable objects. You'll see the like green ball here in the middle. That's the actual interactive piece. I totally understand what I'm interested in. The middle of the puzzle, we're actually going to have another cylinder in the middle that is going to have some additional design. I've got to do some work on that. Basically, at a certain point, this path won't open up until the players have solved a number of other puzzles around the level. No spoilers.
So many spoilers.
Great. So the crappy part is that because I've just
ruined my prefabs.
Have
to all of those prefabs.
I've got to go back through and like redo all of this.
Yes.
So that sucks. Okay. Sorry for wasting everybody's time. I'm wasting my time mostly. You guys can just turn this off. It's fine.
I was waiting for coffee to brew. I'm good.
Coffee? Yeah, coffee's good.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's just take a quick look again. We'll assess our situation. In your circuit manager, these guys are going to go, right?
Yeah, you can tube them.
So those, that's done. We're just going to replace them, and we're going to have to hook all of those back up again anyways.
Yes.
Okay, in your solution nodes, what are these?
So this was the end of it. So this was a node that I created that when, in fact, it received power, it would do something.
Gotcha.
I was in the midst of building when I handed it back to you, though. So
it's not...
You can pretty much build your own.
Okay. So what I might do here, then, is I might just, like, drag that in and turn it off for now.
Yeah.
Because what you're saying is those are the actual fixtures that are going to turn on the bridges.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So when power reaches that specific node,
yes,
its FSM was going to turn on the bridge moments.
I demand my time back. You get no time. Your time is gone. Okay, so hub puzzle.
That's misrepresenting me. That's not what I said.
Okay, so puzzle piece routing switch. What did we call these again? Hub cookie?
Something like that, yeah.
Let's drag those into here. Then I'm just gonna do some tidying up here first. So this is my outer hub. I'm going to make another empty game object in here, and I'm just gonna call this ring. Or so let's use the term geo ring so that we know. This is all of the geometry that correlates to the ring inside. And then what we're going to do after this is we're going to toss all of the other usable cookies inside this ring.
Okay.
How many
objects is that ring made out of? It's broken up pretty finely.
Geo middle. So what you're seeing here are all of the connector bits.
Okay. Cool.
All of the middle
and then one polysurface that is.
Yeah. Okay. So
that makes more sense.
I won't lie, this is gonna get complicated quickly because all of these connector bits also need to be nodes. So we're gonna have to turn all of these into connector nodes as well.
That's true.
So we're not gonna finish that, I think, on the stream today, but it'll take a good hour or two, I think, to set all of this stuff up properly.
Yep.
But I'm hoping I can just get the cookies set up and then we can kind of see from there. And what I might do is just make like a video showing how the whole thing works once we're finished. Okay, so geo middle, including you and you guys all go in here. Geo middle. And now some of this stuff actually isn't. I mean, I'm just going to reorganize it later, but I do know that I want to put the cookies inside these folders. So. Taps, come on. Enter. It's that coffee, I swear.
The lack of.
Yeah. All right. Puzzling through this stuff. So now that's like a little bit more nicely organized, I can start to drag these guys in. And these guys are both in the middle, the inner hub, so I'm just going to put those in here. And once again, make sure I'm lined up to my bottom, and I'm going to go top, duplicate, drag that down there, and then we've got a curved section here. We're going to copy and drag that over here. You are rotated like that. Ugh, there we go. Then we're going to grab this straight section here, copy, drag that down here. You are rotated like this.
I'm going to move that to middle.
And you're going to, we're going to move this into the middle section. And then this curvy guy is going to go duplicate middle. And where do you go? You're going to go over here. We'll rotate you like this. Duplicate.
I really really want this to work in one try.
It won't.
It'd be really cool.
It would be really cool if it did work.
No, it's true, but we haven't set up all the nodes for all the lines in between.
We haven't set up the connectors yet.
That's true.
But it shouldn't take too long. Hold on a tick. We got bottom. Oh, this one actually goes over here. Stop it. There. That one's going to go over here. So like straight curve. Yep, okay. Yeah, a lot of this is really tedious. Just tedious work. But I think I'll appreciate it when it's done. Wes won't. Wes won't appreciate anything. He doesn't. He's underappreciative. Curvy, and then another straight section up here. And this one.
I don't even know what to say in my own defense.
He doesn't. He just doesn't appreciate anything. He doesn't even appreciate good insults.
I do at the very least have a fine appreciation for puns.
Yeah.
Which is necessary around this office. Between Talarian and Chet and this man right here. And I would say Luke as well.
Luke is a pretty
Luke has some puns.
He's pretty punny, yeah.
And all of them are probably equally cringeworthy.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure.
You at least have the excuse of being a dad, though.
I am dad, yeah.
You're allowed to. You and you alone can get away with dad jokes.
Okay. so I was just following the chat line to see if anybody was making fun of us and our puns.
I don't know if I've dropped any cringeworthy puns lately, if at all. I'm trying to think now. I'm sure it's happened.
Oops. One more. Back that way. And duplicate. So close, and yet so far away. And there's another. Okay, hold on a second. There's a straight section here.
Okay, yeah. I was about to say, I'm like, I don't know if you can copy that one. But for some strange reason, you can. That one that you just copied shouldn't have been straight. That should be routing switch.
This is the routing switch? Where's our routing switch? There. Okay, so this guy here. Gone. Where's our routing switch and why is it invisible? Oh, probably because we didn't copy the geo.
Bits over to it, yeah.
So that's fun because we can just go. It looks like it's. Oh, right, because we built it. Does this need to be special?
Yes.
Okay, you've got like FSM stuff going
yeah.
on there.
It's basically, in order for the multiple circuit managers to work, I have to shut one off, turn the other one on.
Gotcha. So what I can do then is I can just grab this and I can just drag these straight into the rotating. I can delete this guy. And then I can just drag this in here.
Should be, yeah.
So I can call this hub cookie routing switch. And then it should be good to go. Because now it'll. Well, wait a second.
Hold on.
Hold on a trick. Those aren't set up properly. You're slightly offset. Why is that? It looks like it's straight. Pivot. The pivot is strange. Why is the pivot strange?
Switch looks a little off-center. Like the target break?
That's actually, yeah, well, they're
kind of all in weird places. The other, well, the frustrating thing is that, like, they're not zeroed. If I grab the rotating group and I zero this, what happens?
Why is that over there?
I really have no idea, but that's fine. That can stay there. But this should definitely be zeroed out. Actually, what I can do is I can, tricks. I can parent that, and then I can zero this one out. Then I can drag this one straight back down into position. Thus. That's weird. 20, 20, 20. Guess that was on purpose. Don't really know now. Okay, and then just drag it back up to position, and then I'll see if that the difference. No, still offset. Why are you offset? The rotating object is at zero. The hub rotating. Oh, okay. I gotta drag the whole thing to position. That's why. Now that should work.
Now you're going to need to move target break back up there.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Target break. And let's just make sure that those spheres are in the right spots too. Pretty good. Okay, so that's our rotating switch. You're equally cringeworthy, Wes. Yes, he is equally cringeworthy. Okay, all right.
Agreed to that instantly.
Save the level and save our project. Because we're so close. This is going to be so much fun when it works. Now, take a step back and think about our... okay, so this... where is the actual geometry for the level? Geo outer.
Oh.
Where are you?
It's on hub outer is the actual mesh right.
Oh, that's just the actual mesh. So that is the geo. Okay, so then I can actually name this one inlay. Outer. Okay. So one by one, what I have to do now. And I'm actually going to do...
I do not envy you this.
I'm going to do myself a solid here, and I'm going to actually... So we do... Okay. So just so people know what's going on here.
Yeah.
If I look at a cookie, say this guy here, there's actually a couple of components going on here. Obviously, this is just the parent that's holding it all together. It's like the folder. Target break is the interactable like snap to point that the players are going to be able to like move their marker to and snap to and use.
Yep.
And it contains all of the logic for using things in our game. You can see that it's shouldn't be a node breakable, but we'll fix that later.
Yeah. It is node. I use node breakable just because it is a shiny, flashy one.
You can see it.
So that you can see that it's there.
But it also contains a Playmaker FSM that also contains information about what happens when it gets flipped. So it's gonna, and I'm assuming those are gonna rotate it as well.
Yep.
So that's where all the logic for this particular piece is stored.
Now, one of the things that's wrong with yours right now, at least, is that you don't actually have the power node on there because you used a different parent object.
Okay. So the folder is gonna need that, right?
Yeah. Previously, those were the power nodes.
What's it called? Circuit node. Circuit node. So this is the helper object to go along with the other script that I showed you earlier. Really all I need to do here, and it doesn't matter, does it, which one goes in where?
No longer, no. With the exception of the power one does. So like when you're doing it for the power nodes, which shouldn't actually, no, those ones should be fine.
Those have been changed.
Yeah.
And I need to assign the, there is no FSM
for
this
yet.
There's
no FSM for that. So pretty much that.
Yeah, and then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to apply those changes.
So that all your cookies, hub cookie sweep gets them.
And then hub cookie straight. So yeah, all of the cookies should, the straight cookies should have this
working now.
Yep.
They all have circuit nodes. They're all pointing to their spheres. And I'm going to do the same thing for curved as well. So curved now gets its own power node. Sphere in. Sphere out. None of them are charged by default. And we're going to apply those changes as well. I did it all for the cookie. The what? And cookie. Yeah, okay, so all of these now have circuit nodes. They can all be used and interacted with. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to copy the spheres. And I'm just gonna paste them in here. Let's start my outer ring. Actually, you know what? Just to make me feel better about my life, I'm going to turn off the outer ring. I'm going to turn off this hallway floor. I'm going to turn off that hallway floor. I'm going to turn off all of these bridges. Let's just clean things up a little bit here. A little bit of breathing room. Ah, so much nicer. Okay, what I'm looking for actually here is just going to start with... where are you? This guy, sure. Now, again, I don't think it matters which ones are connected where.
No, that was a change we put in, so that it'll run reverse along the list as well.
Just so long as the spheres are generally connected to the in and out of that node.
Yep.
I can hold down V and I can actually snap it to the mesh, which is kind of useful. And the tolerances should be set up so that it behaves. That's my in. That's my out. Nope, that didn't work. Let's try that again. Maybe I do have to kind of manually push this. So this is going to be the really tedious part, I think, just making sure that these are all kind of generally aligned. It does not have to be perfect, but they should be relatively close because there might be a few points like here and here, for example, where we need to maintain some level of accuracy. Okay, and then what I can do here is I can actually add a circuit node and assign sphere, and then we can move on. Now, another thing that I could do if I wanted to be really clever is I can remember that these were all set up as quadrants. So I could set one quadrant up and then duplicate it four times.
Quite possibly, yes.
Quite possibly, but given that through the process of importing and exporting and bringing it in here and changing scale and changing position and like manually futzing with the positions of things, I feel like there may be some imprecision here.
Yeah.
And it might not be, it might not line up as well. So I'm probably going to have to do this.
Probably by hand then.
By hand. So.
I'll wheel over here then. I don't think you'll be needing me for a little bit.
This is where, you know, I would really love it if I could just like turn on the Benny Hill theme.
Oh, yeah, and
just like and do the time
of you just
time lapse.
Doing a time lapse of all the pieces coming together.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
That would be great. That would actually be a phenomenal superpower if your superpower was just Benny Hill time speed montages.
Actually, I do. There is one thing I can do here to make this even faster. I'm going to make a link node parent, and then if I drag and drop the spheres underneath the link node, actually not yet. I gotta make sure that it's in the right spot. Link node, you go. Sure, there ish. So now with that placed, I can put the spheres underneath it, and I can assign the circuit node to it. And now what I can do is I can actually copy and paste this link node, and all of the connections will already be made, so I can save a little bit of time here as I go through and manually hook up all of these fiddly bits. Where does that go now? This guy. So now I can just move the link node over here. Uh,
Thankfully, I only need to do this process once. Once it's all done, then we don't have to deal with it anymore. Where are you located? What? You, okay. How many people are following us still? Still got nine people. Nine people are interested in this. So, so as I'm going through this process, I'm always happy to answer any other questions people might have about what it is I'm doing or what is Eon Altar. Encounter zone trigger. Yeah, absolutely. No, this will all be part of an encounter zone trigger in a... basically, what we have in our level is we don't actually have level streaming working right now, so the entire level kind of gets loaded in at once. And thankfully, the world geometry for most of our levels is fairly simple, so the load times aren't super ridiculous. And we've done a fairly good job of trying to atlas all of our textures and memory and all that. But what really hurts is when you start the level and all of the enemies and all of the interactions and all of the colliders all spawn at once, and it really, really, really slows down gameplay. So ages ago, we built a system that, Joey built a system that allows us to kind of shove that all into a zone, and when the players enter that zone, it loads everything in kind of smartly and staggers the loading, so it's not quite as noticeable. So given the number of colliders and the number of interactable objects in this zone, it will all definitely be part of its own little encounter zone, so it doesn't stay loaded in memory as you play through the level. Okay, this is actually going a little bit faster than I thought it would, which is nice. So really all we're doing is we're creating the ins and outs for these various sections. Kind of frustrating because these links aren't their center points aren't centered, so I don't know exactly where they are. Mumble, mumble, mumble. Ty Roder saying I'm mumbling. That's likely to happen. You can all put on some soundtracks and watch me work slowly and carefully. As I slowly work my way around this ring. Now, one of the saving graces of the system that I've built is that it doesn't actually require us to... Why are you making each individual thing links? Can't I go across the divide just fine since it's logically one piece? Well, it's not actually. So the reason why this works actually so easily... Yeah, I'm doing the sections in between. So, like, for example, we've set up this piece, so, like, in and out, and then this piece has an in and out. But they won't know that they're connected. So I'm actually creating all of the connector bits right now. The great thing about the way that I've built this system is it, I don't actually need to create the connections. I don't need to assign the connections. So I don't need to actually say that this bit is connected to this bit and this connected to that bit. I just need to know where all the connections are. And I can let the level kind of do it itself. It can handle itself. This is just kind of a bit of a time-consuming process. Across cross the outer inner ring divide. Well, it will. There will be like they will automatically connect between these bits. Technically I could do one like solid chunk for these sections here. I would be potentially making a little bit more performance and making it a little bit easier on myself. But in the event that we ever want to move these rings independently, it's also kind of a good idea to just set it up properly. Link node. So every half hour or so, I like to just remind the people who are watching that this is content we're making for episode 3. We haven't announced the launch date yet for it, but we do now have a free playable demo that we just put up on Steam. That includes the first level, which is the prelude. And so if you've been kind of waiting to try Eon Altar or not really sure what the game is all about, you can just go to Steam and pick it up for free. The handset apps are free as well. So if that's kind of like one of the things that is stopping you from making a purchase because you're not sure how it works, just go pick up the demo. It's really fun. A great couch co-op game. For people who like to get together and play games with their friends. And this is time consuming. Okay. Now there probably are a lot of methods that I could have used along the way to make this easier for myself, but honestly, I think at a certain point you just gotta roll your sleeves up and get the work done. Now, this is error prone. There's probably been mistakes that I've made along the way. The cool thing is that once I've set up all of the connector nodes and once they're actually set up to turn on and off, it'll be pretty easy to debug. Basically, what's going to happen is, like I said, they're starting from the power source. It's going to start tracing its way out to any other nodes that are like in the immediate vicinity. And if it can't find any, it'll just stop. So I'll be able to really quickly figure out which nodes are actually working and which ones aren't, and make sure that all of these kind of spheres are positioned where they're supposed to be. Yeah, this is going pretty quickly. I'm pretty much halfway finished now, I'd say. Starting to get into a bit of a rhythm here, so. Once this is done, this puzzle is going to be glorious. Surface, maybe move that sphere a little bit further in. Yeah, adding the spheres to a parent that automatically has all the connections set up has really saved me a lot of time. Okay, where are you located? So for those of you who are following along the channel, I'll maybe just do a quick poll. I'm interested to see if anybody's played the game, who are your favorite characters and why? Let's start a discussion because this is going to take a little while. If you've played the game, there are the five playable characters. Which one do you play the most? Which one do you think has the best story? I want to know. We're starting to pull... some of our metrics, so we can kind of see what characters people are playing. And good to know it anecdotally. Marcus, yeah, Canadian Snowman Wes has a thing for dwarves. That didn't come out right. Sorry, Wes. I mean, like, fantasy dwarves. Still not much better.
Nope, not much better. How about yourself? What is your favorite character?
You know, it's interesting. So being the one who kind of went through and did a lot of the work to kind of rebalance the characters, Luke and I were the ones who kind of built the characters to begin with. We set up their stories, we set up their backstories, kind of figured out what kind of people they should be. Over the course of the last couple of years developing the game, I've kind of ended up liking all of them at one point or another most.
I was gonna say you can't get away with that.
But recently, just because of, I think more or less just because it's the one that we've been playing through with our playtest over the past couple of weeks,
mm-hmm.
really kind of started to develop a bigger affinity for Silent Thorn.
Ah.
And she's always kind of been like in my top three in terms of favorite characters. Just because she's got this like really good power set. There's obviously a couple of things that I'd really like to fix about it,
yes.
especially to make her assassination field a little bit more useful. But generally, I love the feeling of like seeing her run away, open fire with her arrow. The animation where she like flips her bow open just gets me every time. And as much as there was like a strong campaign against her double shot, like there was a pretty strong lobbying contingency to get rid of it. I feel like it makes her interesting that like she gets to like Legolas the heck out of her enemies. And
we just need to put in the shield sliding animation so she can slide downstairs and shoot people.
Yeah, maybe not. Pick your favorite child. Yeah, I only actually have one child, so it's easy for me to pick my favorite.
The campaign against Doubleshot is still, I think that's still on. I don't think it's so much the idea of it that they were fighting, though. It was a balanced one.
Yeah, it gets a bit, like, especially when you upgrade it to level 4, which is
yeah.
kind of tricky to do in the first couple of episodes, but... definitely possible. It does get pretty OP pretty quickly.
Yep.
Man, almost done here with this middle ring. And then the middle ring is probably not going to take quite as long. In fact, I might end up doing my copy-paste for the middle because I'm a little bit more confident in the middle shapes being accurate. Actually, you know what I could do? This I'm gonna make things easier for myself here. I'm gonna grab all of these ones, can I? And then I'm gonna turn them off. Yes. And then I'm gonna turn these ones off. And now I know which ones I haven't done yet. Should have done this first. Just to make it really easy on myself. Okay, so that one is there's just like one straggler kicking out. Where's that one? Over there. You didn't get a link node. Why didn't you get a link node? Oh well.
That is very true.
Yeah, the double slow is actually kind of the biggest thing. I think the ability for the first shot to do slowing, but the second one not to. But the feeling of double shot feels good.
The feeling of double shot feels good. I will say that. Maybe one fine day we can manage like a forked shot or something. fire and have it hit two targets.
Yeah, I was thinking of like a ricochet of some sort would be kind of nifty if she could like have it ricochet off one target onto another. Would be pretty stellar.
But does a lot less damage. Yeah. He's suggesting first shot do the damage, and then the second shot is more of a it's the CC basically, the slow part of that.
Yeah.
Sounds good here.
But mostly for Silent Thorn, I think the bigger thing is trying to make sure that things like assassinate, and eviscerate. That those work.
Yeah, her stealth right now, it needs a little bit of a buff.
Yeah, we're also talking about eventually wanting to make her Shadow Step a little more interesting. She can't really use Shadow Step. So the thing with Shadow Step that sucks is that you end up wasting a turn,
mm-hmm.
effectively getting into that position to use it. And we really need a way to...
Make that feel kick-ass. Yeah.
So either we make it a free action so she can continue to do something after, or I don't know, or we just make it do something. I think right now, like, if you upgrade it, it gives you there's like a debuff that happens. I think it's weakened or
demoralized.
Takes place on all of the enemies in a radius around you because they get caught in your shadow ink. Your octopus ink, I guess.
I never thought of it that way.
Just like, get away! Poof!
There's actually like a physical representation of the shadows billowing out from her. I always thought, you know, it's just like, oh no, that's us being like, she's slipping into the shadows, but if she was actually just like, ink!
Yeah.
I'm vanished!
You can't catch me anymore.
It rules.
Basically, that's what's happened. Oh, man. It's getting close.
Oh, you actually have most of this done?
Yep.
Are those going to play nice? Those really super short links that you're making?
We're gonna have to fiddle with it. Like Luke said, we might end up having to make the interior connectors like reach out a ways so that they're not, because like, basically what you're looking at is these sections here, right? Where like that connects to that connects to that, and having three of those nodes like in really close order might actually be a big problem. So we might actually just have to go in out.
Suppose we could put like a spacer ring in.
Yeah, we could.
Same as the outer ring. Like, you could almost fit an additional outer ring between the inner and middle.
Yeah. But again, the problem is that the geo pieces are connected to rings that are, like, completely unconnected. So, like, the spheres, if we ever animate these rings, they actually detach from each other, which could pose an issue. So that's why I'm kind of building it the way that it's designed to be built right now, and then if there are issues later, we can address them as they come up.
I suppose worst case we could kill the threshold on a couple of the nodes.
Yeah, we can. Well, no, because you have to. You set the tolerance on the master circuit.
Yeah. Okay. In that case, we could get really, really, really exacting with those positions. As soon as we know everywhere that it rotates, we could probably actually line them up perfectly.
Probably.
And then just actually set the threshold to zero. Or zero.
Oh yeah, because we could literally just snap their positions so they line up exactly.
Yeah.
I will leave that job to you, probably.
That sounds fair.
Okay, so now these are almost in position. I feel like I'm kind of like Bob Ross. In a way, just like happy little trees.
Got a happy little cookie over here.
Just
Just a happy little cookie. Just. Just putting some spheres in. Sphere.
He gave us the same quote even.
Ah, two more nodes. And then the inside.
Oh, that's middle ring done?
Middle ring is, yeah, basically done. Process was pretty quick. Gotta say, not as bad as I thought. Was that like 30 minutes? Probably 4 days. I would have been home in 4 days. My, how time flies. Okay, sphere. Here. And finally this piece here. You go there. Yeah, I'm definitely gonna do some copy pasting in the next section to try and speed some time up here. Great. And then there was one more I think at the top that didn't get one. So let's not forget about it. This one, that was that guy there. It's weird. Okay, middle, that's all of the chunks of the middle. I'm gonna turn that off. Well, actually, so we'll turn all of them on. Are there parts that didn't get nodes? Oh, just some of them have been disabled, I see. What in the world? There we go. So now I can see all of those nodes for the outer ring have been assigned. They've been placed. Everything is good to go. I'm going to just leave those rolled open, but I'm going to close the entire middle section and done. Let's move on to the inner circle now, where there are thankfully and mercifully a lot less
save.
Pieces. Oh, yes. Yeah, save. Oh, I lost it. Sorry, guys. We have to go. Yeah, that would suck.
Well, I suppose it is, actually. It's 10 to 3.
10 to 3 already. I've been going for some time, but I do really want to get through the long haul here because I feel like we're in good shape to finish this puzzle right now.
That'd be slick.
Or at the very least, get in position where we can test it. I would hate to leave this this stream and not have tested the issues.
Yeah, I know, right?
Yeah.
Do all the setup and we're just like, yeah, okay, we assume it works, guys. Talk to you next
week. I'm sure it'll work. We'll let you know what the cool parts
do
later.
Not going to show you any of the neat fiddly bits.
Nope, not going to happen. Okay, now, what I'm going to do here is something that I said I wasn't going to do last time, but I'm confident in this part that that's going to work better. Mostly because I can see now that the all of these objects, if I scroll through them, you can see that their pivot points are all the same. Which means that if I, in fact, just... let's identify one of the quadrants here. That guy, non-gender-specific guy. All of these ones over here. And then what I can do is I can just delete all of these. I will just duplicate them again.
okay. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 should be okay. Probably don't even need this bit here. Probably just do this 3 times. 1, 2, 3. And then what I'll do is I will just grab these that needs to be parented. 1, 2, 3. Duplicate. And if I rotate them 180 degrees. Actually, let's do 90. Duplicate them again. 120. Nope, 180. Again, 90. Yeah, okay, so what you can see is, like, it's mostly lines up, but there are some areas where it does kind of fall apart because the geo was not exactly precise. Just as, like, basically what happened is yesterday I brought in a bunch of paths into Maya, and I used them to carve out these shapes into the geometry. You can see here, if I grab it, you can see all the wires. And what happened as a result of the Boolean was that some of those, like, it just kind of approximated it. So you'll see in sections where, like, because I've duplicated this geometry, it's, well, actually, I'm gonna undo this, actually, because this is gonna look kind of janky if I leave it like this. If I go back to before I deleted the geo, that only took, what, like a minute. Let's just turn these off for now. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to set these up again one more time, but this time I'm not going to parent the link nodes. So I want to keep the existing geometry where it is, but I want to position the link nodes where they belong. That's the tedious part. That's the time waster. And finally, this one here. I use the term finally a lot, I just realized, and none of these are finally. There's a lot more steps. Just like finally in this process. Okay, now with these minimized.
It's always a weird moment where your brain does sort of just register that you've been saying that word so many times. Then you have to actually make a conscious effort not to for a little while. At least personally.
Yeah.
I found this about myself.
Great. So now what I've done is I've just placed these nodes where they belong, and I can just drag those out and delete these 3 duplicated surfaces. Duplicate it again. These ones out, delete those surfaces, duplicate it again, and delete those surfaces, and what I'll do then is I can just turn these ones on, and then I can just figure out where they belong. So these ones I turn off, don't need them anymore. What are you? You're there. So you go there, turn you there. Turn it off. There. Turn it off. I suspect that the rest of these are all in order, so I'm just gonna, I'll verify after, but I'm pretty sure they all go together just like that. Oops. Nope, I was wrong. Where is that one? That one's, that one goes to there. That one goes to there. No? All sorts of wrong. Well, that one's correct. Turn that one off. You go there. You go there. I think you go there. No. Well, you're done. Pretty soon this thing's gonna work and it's gonna look amazing. There. It's just about lining up the right nodes. That one. Aha. I finished it. And says done. And that actually took a lot less time than the other one did. And that one's all kind of neatly lined up. Now, I've got my inner and I have my middle and outer rings. I turn them on. Whomp, and if I select the inner again, you can see all of those connective points. And you can see some of them, like, they don't quite line up together. I could go back in now that all of them are placed and try and align those. But again, I think that's a thing I can leave to Wes. If there's actually a problem, we can fix it if it needs to be fixed. But for now, let's leave that. What I need to do now is just make sure that those power nodes are connecting properly. Over here, the power node does connect to the outside ring in both of those positions. That's good. So, Wes, the power node here, circuit manager power nodes are connected to there and there, so the,
yes,
that should be good. So our outlets are going to work. And if I in fact grab the hub inner, geo inner, all of these objects, roll them open, and this object, and then I grab hub outer. It's going to be a lot of spheres here that I'm going to have to grab manually, and that's going to be a couple minutes of work, probably. Hub routing switch. Soon. Yes, soon trademarked. So basically the last thing that has to happen here is I need to find all of those spheres, because those are actually, I'm wondering. So this was the circuit manager. We deleted all of the extraneous objects. So what I could technically do is do a search for circuit node or link node.
No, circuit node should work. Like, that's giving you everything that has one on it.
I've already got the power nodes established. So now if I just grabbed all of that, there's nothing else in the level that I could be selecting here.
Nope.
I think that's all of them.
With the exception of
this,
like,
thing?
One switch is in there.
Is that this guy here?
Routing switch.
He has a link node for some reason, the circuit node.
Well, it makes sense. He was the parent object. You put one on just a moment ago. Well, a couple more than a couple moments now.
Oh, it looks like that routing switch got doubled up again.
Oh,
What's happening here?
That might be it.
No. Okay, what's happening then? This is the spheres on either side.
Yeah.
No,
well, the switches itself are going to have the power node on them, so that seems right to me.
So hub cookie routing switch is fine, but this guy, it looked like there was a... That's weird. Yeah, no, it looked to me like there was a circuit node on there. Well, let's just see what happens. So if I grab all... Oh, wait. These ones... Where are these guys? Puzzle piece corner? How's the circuit node? Oh. Weird.
Oh, you have nested nodes.
Yeah, that shouldn't be the case.
Nope. Oh, that's because you dragged in the previous prefabs that I had made.
Correct. So I'm just going to turn these back on. I'm going to see what's going on here. If I go cookie curved...
You could just drag the target break and rotating out of that thing and then drop it under the hub.
I'm just going to check and see what spheres they're pointing to. They're both pointing to the same spheres.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to remove this from the...
And just leave the...
Apply that change, and that should fix that problem. So if I grab this curved corner, it doesn't have that anymore. Huzzah! Okay, now if I go in circuit node... So I'm just doing like a quick search for anything in the level that has a circuit node component attached. And now I can grab all of the link nodes, all of the hub cookies. Again, what's that one? Just a weird name. Why didn't it get named? That was probably the first one I built. Honestly, I probably just forgot to change the name. Let's turn these ones back on so we can see them. There we go. And we'll grab all of them, except the power nodes, because those have already been assigned. And all I have to do now, theoretically, is assign those to the manager.
Oh, not the way you're thinking of, because you don't actually use the object, you have to use the script.
Right, so I have to lock that first.
Yeah, and then you gotta manually go through, basically crack open another inspector and then just go through and manually drag them one at a time in there.
All right, well, let's clean this one up. Man, we're so close, I can taste it. So the power node is in here already and the routing switch is in here already. I'm just gonna clean up these lists. Actually, power node 2 and cookie routing switch.
I was figuring you were about to just cut it down to 2.
That would have worked too. I'm not gonna find the stupid routing switch. There you are.
Again, you gotta use the scripts, not the objects.
Are you sure?
I'm quoting you, actually.
Because this is a list. This is a list of nodes. So if I grab the link node and I drag it into here, it should go, and I should get the circuit node. It'll automatically find the circuit node object.
Pascal is a jerk.
I think
who caused me an unbelievable amount of pain.
You might still be right. You might still
again,
be right.
I'm quoting you. You're fighting yourself in this particular battle.
I don't need the routing switch though, because that's already been assigned. And I'm gonna see what happens if I just drag and drop. I've got a lot of circuit node references. So it's found the circuit node on all of those top level objects. I think what you might have been trying to do is grabbing like the parent object and dragging it in, whereas like you actually need the object that has that script.
Oh no!
You
were implicit in your directions of you have to click and drag the script. That was also when you taught me about opening up dual inspectors and the whole bit.
Oh yeah, dueling inspectors.
Yep.
Spy versus spy.
Pass, Scott.
Well, let's.
let's see how this works anyways. I've got the cookie routing switch, and I'm assigning all of these to... Ah, wait, no, stop. I have to go back. Power node. Power node, that's the one I want. So we're creating both of those chains by essentially telling the circuit managers what wires are in the solution, and that should be good. Those are all circuit nodes. That's done. Let's see if that did what it was supposed to do. I'm just gonna go through here and roll these closed so I don't have a ton of crap all over the place. Now, is there a way for me to run this and test it by itself, I wonder? Probably could copy and paste this into the exploration level.
Yep.
We're gonna save that first, though.
Alternatively, you do have it over terrain that is, like, there's already a nav mesh going right to that thing, so you could actually just walk in there right now and skip FE, and it should work.
Hypothetically, we could do that. I just have to move the puzzle down just below the navigable terrain so we can snap to it. So I could try that.
It'll actually work if it's a bit above.
Will it?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. Save the file again. All right, everybody. Moment of truth. I've been working on this for hours now.
Two hours now, yeah. Well, not counting yesterday.
That was art, though. That was a different me for a different time. I very much dislike how you can save a scene in Unity and have
and
it immediately
still has,
be dirty.
Yes. Yeah. No, drives me nuts.
Because I'm like, is it saved? I really don't know.
Most of the time now, if I'm going to, like, you know, jump a scene to sort of test something out, then usually I'll just open up the scene so that it'll escape before I have to look at it being dirty again.
Haven't run this scene in a really long time, so I don't know if this is gonna work per se. Also,
stream just dies right now. They have no idea. We're just like, and test.
The whole thing just goes down. So a couple things that won't work. Obviously, we haven't hooked up the fade script yet, so the lines aren't going to fade.
So all
of them
will be bright all the time.
Yeah.
So
there is no way to visually know if it's working?
No.
At the moment? Other than to just, like, basically it's like
you're going to click on them and check and see if they're charged.
It's the game design equivalent of sticking a circuit tester to the end and seeing if it has charge.
I'm so glad you said circuit tester instead of fork. I thought you were about to say fork, and I was just like, no, we're a little more precise than that.
That's how you do electrical work, right? You just stick a fork in it.
Yep.
It's like, it's done.
Well, I know a bunch of, like, hardcore electricians that actually just do that with their fingers. They don't even bother with a circuit tester. Because apparently, you know, you can actually just create a circuit by touching, like, I think you touch the unpowered line first and then touch the powered one.
Oh, yeah?
And then it'll just create a conduit right through your fingers so you can just feel it going through you.
That sounds dangerous.
It's incredibly dangerous. If you touch the lav one first, you die.
Yeah, let's not do that.
Yeah, no. That's the equivalent of the fork, I guess.
It takes a long time to load for some reason.
Longer than I was expecting, that's for sure.
It could have crashed.
Does it still have a?
Is it still juicing?
No, it's still eating up some CPU. So it's thinking.
700 megs. No more. It's not taking up any more memory though, which tells me it might just be like.
That's true.
Gacked.
Gacked. I don't think it's a verb that a program can use. Program gagged. This is the longest drum roll in history. This is just. It's still going on.
GAC. GAC is actually a verb in programming.
What?
Probably garbage allocation collector or something. I don't know.
General algorithmic collector.
Geosynchronous. Algorithmic. Oh, global assembly cache.
I mean, obviously.
That was going to be my next guess. Yeah, some tells me this is gone. It's gone. Let's just hope that the three times that I hit Control S actually saved the level. Oh my goodness.
CLI assembly.
For the common language infrastructure. Or the CLI.
The CLI. I don't think people call it CLI.
That's looking good. Promising, anyways. You know what?
DLL hell. You're just going to go through front end instead.
Well, I was just wondering if maybe we could really quickly set up. So where's our charger here? So what I'd like to do here is maybe just set it up so that the routing switch. I'm going to add a component to this. I'm going to add a Playmaker component.
Are you? Oh, there it goes.
We're going to set charge and discharge. And with Playmaker open, this is our, if you use Unity and you don't have Playmaker, you should use it. You really should, because it's incredibly handy for visual scripting.
It's like Kismet or Blueprint for those Unreal users.
Yes.
And it's wonderful.
So I've got a charge event, and I've got a discharge event.
Occasionally horrible.
So this is going to be what happens when we charge it, and this is what's going to happen when we discharge it. And I'm also going to set up a hold up a second. On the cookie itself, I have the line, the energy line. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a fade component, in and out shader float. I just want to see how fast it takes me. I'm going to be affecting the luminance channel, and we're going to have a start delay of 0, a speed of 1.
Yeah, fair enough.
And we're going to copy that and paste as new. This one's going to be a max float of 0, fade and speed of 1. This one's going to be turned off. I'm going to turn them both off, actually. Now, when you discharge, you're going to... disable that one. And you're going to enable this one. And when you charge, you're going to do the opposite. Then we just need to set our global transitions to charge and discharge.
Are you going to be able to do that? Oh, no, you can have state ends. Okay.
Yep. And then...
I think you need an additional start state, but that's okay.
I should be able to do the same thing for these guys as well fairly quickly. So again, on our hub cookie curve, we're going to add a Playmaker FSM. We're going to assign it to the list here. We're going to add a new state. This one's going to be called discharge. Probably can. Charged. Probably have to reassign everything anyways. You guys were so close, and then it crashed, and now I've gotten on a tangent. float. Luminance max float of 1. It takes you a second to get there. Copy and oops. Paste is new. This one's gonna fade it out. We'll turn them both off. And in our charge, I'm just gonna set enabled to on. Set enabled to off. Copy, paste, flip. So basically what I've done is still doesn't have a good state machine replacement. Nope, it does not. Probably because everybody uses Playmaker, and why not? It works. So basically what I've done here is I've I have these scripts attached to the glowing track piece. One of them sets the float value of one of the shader options, which is this guy here, Luminance. So if I turn it on or off, you can see it goes from the black obsidian off state to the green glowing on state. This one turns it on, this one turns it off. I'm leaving both of these scripts disabled. And what's gonna happen is whenever these events, charge, discharge, get called, it's going to flip these on and off. And the final thing that I have to do here is just make sure that I'm calling charge and discharge as my events. And what'll happen is when this circuit node says, hey, you're charged, it'll talk to the Playmaker FSM, call the charge event, and actually make those lights flip on and off. Now, I'd have to do this one more time, basically for the straight pieces. But then all of the cookies and the in-out node are gonna be set up and ready to go. I think Wes might be right. I think I can actually copy these states and paste them into a different option. Yep, I can. However, the target object needs to change, so I just need to grab the correct object and drag that in instead. That won't work. I need to grab the the object doesn't exist. So fade in out shader float. Luminance 1 1 1. Copy component, paste component is new. 0. And I'm just gonna remove these because I don't trust their connections. This is my charge, so I want you to be on. And this is my discharge. I want you to be off. Done and done. Copy those events, move them over here, and flip them. And now I'm just going to save the scene. And I'm going to apply that change to that prefab. And now you'll notice that it's applied that prefab, but you can see the FSM is now applied to all of these objects as well. So now what I should expect when I start the scene is that all of these outside glowing lights are gonna be on by default. There, I haven't set any of these up to be switched on and off based on state. I will eventually, but for now they haven't been set up to work that way. Instead what's gonna happen is these cookies are going to light up properly if they're in the right orientation. And that's kind of what I want to see. I just want to make sure that they're all aligned and working correctly. So that should help us out. Now let's see what happens if I run the game. Hopefully it does not crash. That would be nice.
That'd be cool.
Also really hoping that all of the rotation for all of these things is set up properly and it just works. Man, so many little steps of cleanup that we still have to do with this puzzle, though. We want to have we're going to have kind of like a cascading effect. So as you run down the pathway, all of the lights are going to flick on.
Yeah.
And when you finally get to the bottom of the ramp, I think that's when we're going to have the bridge kind of float up out of the water. Those are all going to be player-driven moments, though, I think.
Yep.
Seeing this puzzle just kind of rise up out of the lake is going to be pretty awesome.
I'm looking
Yeah, me too.
That would be really cool.
And then we're still thinking of doing like a flip sort of thing for Davian's puzzle.
Yeah.
But we might have to look at other options there, because I'm not sure. It might get too complicated for animation.
It might get too complicated.
Did it crash again? Like, am I just incapable of running the game?
Well, that'd be bad.
It's sucking up more memory now than it was before, but...
You check the log. See if anything really obvious is sitting in there. Where it's just like, hey, you created an infinite loop, which is possible. Like, what's happening right now was what happened to me anytime when I created an infinite loop in your circuit manager.
Oh, okay. So there could be a bug here.
Yeah.
Helpful to know. All right, well, I'm just going to assume that's the case.
So this at least happened when I was trying to use a single point of contact as the power source. I was trying to use a sphere as both in and out points.
Gotcha.
So I'm guessing that some of your points are crossing thresholds or something.
I'm like crossing that. The streams.
Yeah, you're crossing the streams.
Right, so total protonic reversal. I've been told that would be bad.
Yeah.
Someone said that once.
So that's bad.
All right, let's take a peek. We've got hub puzzle.
I suppose one nice easy way you could test to make sure that it is the puzzle, you could turn the puzzle off and try to run the level.
That's true, we could. Let's just take a quick peek here. Maybe you can help me suss this. So I have power node 1 assigned to the power node 1 circuit manager.
As it well should.
And if I kind of like hover over the sphere,
yep.
That's power node 1. Power node 2 sphere is over here.
Yep.
But power node 2 connects to power node 2.
Yep, which is fine. So that's all well, good, and wonderful.
Then I don't have that.
Are both of those on to start with?
Yes.
We could try turning one of them off.
Oh, wait, the circuit manager is disabled in one of them.
Then that should be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now the power nodes are both turned on by default.
Yeah, they should both be on.
Okay.
And they should actually both be charged as well.
They should both be charged. Are they both charged? Yes. Okay. So that should be fine.
That should be fine.
Let's try turning off the circuit managers and just making sure that that is the reason why this is bailing.
Yeah.
We can also actually get into the level and run around. Oh, the beginning section, I haven't re-nav meshed, so it might be a little broken.
It's probably going to be a little broken.
It's probably going to be a little broken. That's one of the fun parts of game design.
Floating.
Drum roll, please.
Yeah, I know, right? Let's see if this does explode the same way.
It does end up taking a minute usually.
Yeah.
Just gonna check my task manager. Memory's still floating, disk is still being used. That's promising. So there definitely was an issue with the circuit man.
Yep, there it goes.
Sweet. Yeah, okay, so as expected, I'm floating through the air. Welcome to episode 3. There's a weird man standing there. I won't tell you who it is.
Strange. Okay. Oh, no. Might need to drag him through that.
That's okay, actually. Yeah, I might need to drag him through it. All of those things have kicked, so... Spoiler alert! That's right, it is a spoiler. Can I drag him? Do I just grab him?
Yes, you can drag him. And as long as there is nav mesh on the other side.
That's a good question. Is there nav mesh? There should be.
You should be able to put it. Nope, doesn't tell him where to budge from that spot either. What a jerk. I guess you could kill his nav mesh agent for a second. Should be able to slide around that.
If I just grab the actor and wrench it, where's the nav mesh agent here?
I genuinely can't recall.
Now have mesh agent there. Nope, I can't turn it off. Or is it under his visual? I just don't know anymore. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to try and actually just pause the game and move him physically over to the bridge.
Nice.
And see what happens.
He's sick of your crap.
He just doesn't want to move there, and I'm not sure why.
It doesn't take long to hop out, remake, and hop back in, I guess.
Yeah. Well, that's the strange thing, is that there is navigable mesh here.
Yeah, it's just, you could probably connect those two when he's standing on those ramps up. There's a break in the mesh right there.
There standing on. Is a break here.
Yeah, but he's a cat, man. He should be able to climb it, no problem.
Yeah, he should be a good climber. He should be a really good climber.
That's science.
All right, so let's make sure here. So we've got this section here is probably fine. He can connect that. That is probably too high. I might have to paint this smoother. And just kind of like gradually increase the size. I'll just like paint on some taller terrain here and then smooth it out. Man, just full opacity. Totally smooth.
Yeah, that should work. Gray looks a lot better.
All right. We'll try that. Then I also probably need to make sure that there is a walkable pathway here.
Well, didn't it have navigation there?
It probably would have.
Alternatively, you can grab that really ugly nav cube that I had thrown down there before.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find out where I dropped that. Navigation meshes. Cubes. All right.
Is it inside the bridge?
Nav carvers, is that it?
No, that's the lower one. I'm betting it was one of those top four, but I think it's inside the bridge right now. Either that, or you deleted it.
Yeah, that's possible too. It needs to be on. It just needs a box collider, right?
Yeah. Well, and just needs to be tagged static. Really.
So that will make it bakeable, but then we also don't have the ground cube beneath it that we need to.
Yeah, you don't necessarily need to be able to slide along it right now. You'll still be able to free run on it.
Gotcha. Okay, so let's just do a quick nav bake. Bulleted. Spooky background music. Yeah, did a good job of our background music. Okay, so now I should be able to walk and traverse that path pretty clearly.
Looks like.
Let's try that. Saving.
Still circuit manager's off. Cool.
But I'm assuming that if I turn the circuit manager on, it's just going to blow up.
Yeah. Quite possibly.
It's a safe assumption.
It's a fairly safe assumption.
Let's go for a run. Gotta fix those chains. They're supposed to be much longer. Oh, no way. Just not close enough. Oh, he'll go there. Alright. So, you can interact with these guys.
Try giving a switch a turn to see how the rotate works. Fits.
Fuck. But you will notice, everybody, that all of the middle pieces are turned off. It by default turned them off because they've all been discharged.
Looks like all of the straight pieces are actually swinging out of alignment, though.
The
rotating out of their sockets. Just like that first one did as well. So I'm betting that some part of the curve or the straight one got... Because that straight one works. So you already corrected the...
It rotates back into its regular position.
Yeah.
Yeah, this one was fixed.
Yeah, so you fixed that one, so you just... I think it's probably the exact same problem where you brought in the old piece and it still has some...
Okay, so here's the moment of truth. If I turn this on, I'm expecting the whole thing to just... The circuit manager is disabled in power mode 1. Let's try power mode 2.
Okay.
Done. Crashed. There's a problem with the circuit manager.
Yeah.
Cool. So now we get to do some debugging. I will just say that looks really cool.
That does look really
cool. Yeah. We might want to add a little trigger so the camera comes up above a little bit more so the players can see the shape.
See a little bit more of the puzzle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because as it stands right now, it might be actually kind of difficult to do the puzzle if you can't see the whole thing at once.
Well, once you actually have pieces where you can start seeing it light up,
that's probably just super crashed because there's a loop there. Getting super close though.
Yep.
A lot of that.
It's pretty close.
A lot of that stuff is coming together. No, I'm pretty confident there's an infinite loop there. It's stuck in a while statement that's not. Or a force statement that's not terminating. Like,
yeah.
Bouncing, cascading back and forth eternally.
Luke's checking for where we're at.
Checking for where we're at.
Because we did have a meeting plan for 3.
Oh, yeah. So I'm kind of running over the time that I'd set aside for this stream. And I think we've gotten to a pretty good place. You can kind of see some of the functionality coming together. I think the next part is mostly just going to be debugging and trying to get the fade in and out working. But for those of you who are watching the stream right now, I think you can see pretty clearly where we're headed and what this is going to look like when it's done. I'm hoping that despite the really boring, like, 45 minutes of attaching power nodes to things, it's not the most riveting entertainment.
Nope.
I think watching people riveting is probably a lot more riveting entertainment than this was. But I hope you learned something, today.
I learned something at least.
Yeah. What did you learn?
In this particular case, I'm still going back to past Scott as a jerk.
that's what everybody's learning today.
That was the takeaway.
So,
unless of course that actually might be what's causing the problem. It might've been that when you drag the game objects in that it decided to. No, but all of those should have single nodes in them, so it shouldn't matter.
That was the problem. You were trying to drag in a game object with two different power nodes, because you were trying to do a two power node thing.
No, that was later.
Oh,
this was still Pascot.
Pascot. Well, we're gonna do some debugging. We're gonna get to the bottom of it, and maybe we'll post a GIF or something, a GIF.
A GIF.
On Twitter, just to show what this looks like when it's done.
That'd be good.
Yeah. I also suspect this is probably going to make its way into the teaser trailer design somehow.
Yeah.
It's a pretty cool little design here. All right. Well, I think we're going to cut the stream short. Again, if anybody has any questions, always feel free to hit us up on Facebook or Twitter. And always happy to answer those questions for you. It's not graphics. Yeah, totally. GIF. It's a GIF. People, GIF. Eon Altar is available on Steam. Episodes 1 and 2 are available. This is from episode 3. We don't have a launch date yet for it, but it's coming in the winter. And we just launched a demo. You can get the demo on Steam. It's free. Get the handsets. Get the demo. Give it a try. Handsets are also free. If you just want to play the prelude, it's just
free.
Yeah, and then episodes 1 and 2 are available as well. So we will be back again probably next Thursday, but expect to see an update on this in the next couple of days. Cool. Thanks, guys.